The My Miller Show. Today I have two special guests today, two wonderful business owners. Their names are Reid and Sheila. They are the owners of Vegan East. They have three locations, two in Minneapolis and one in White Bear Lake. So let's tune in so we can hear more about them and what amazing things that they've been doing. Hi Sheila.
Hi.
Hi Reid. Welcome Hello. To my show. So before we get started, let's tell us about yourself. What brought you guys here? What inspired you to get into baking, and why vegan?
Oh my goodness, such a long story. But originally, like, I didn't bake before, really. Before I met Reid, it was more of a hobby. Mm-hmm. Now that I was in a relationship, I was just kind of looking for things to do at home, and so I started baking. I started baking normal, like using normal products, and then we went vegetarian. I don't remember what year it was. 2015. Mm-hmm. So yeah, we were vegetarian, and you know, had my own cake business. It was called Sheila Cakes at the time. Yeah. but just did for friends and family. Aww. And a couple like customers that I didn't know. And then I heard, you know, a voice inside of me, my own voice, was like, hey, why don't you try vegan baking? Yeah. So I don't know why, but I heard it and I followed it, and I was like, okay, I guess I'll try it. And after a couple of months, then I got the final product, and then we started selling. You know, it was slow. You know, we still marketed. I don't know if we came up with the name right away. Did you call it Veganese?
Yeah, I mean, you sold a little bit under Sheila Cakes, mm-hmm. and then, you know, we decided we wanted to kind of make a real business out of it, so we got the domain name, the Instagrams, all that stuff, and we wanted to reserve all that, so we switched over to Vegan East.
Yeah. Vegan, because what point did we become vegan and then do this?
Yeah, so... Sheila started vegan baking before she even became vegan, which I think is a very interesting part of the story, if you will. And that was probably in early 2016 or so. In mid 2016 or late 2016, we actually went vegan ourselves. Mm-hmm. And then our first event was VegFest. Which was, you know, something that we had just seen on our phones. Mm-hmm. Hey, we're looking for vendors for VegFest here.
And that was when I picked up the cakes from you.
Oh, yeah.
And I mean, we had done several VegFest since then, I think three. I think our first one was in 2017. And, you know, that went really, really well for us. And, you know, we didn't necessarily envision this, you know, 5 years ago when this had started. But, you know, we had gotten such positive feedback from the community. Mm-hmm. We had sold out so quickly that we're like, hey, let's pursue this a little bit further. And it's just sort of, you know, we kind of take on the mindset of just 1% better every single day.
Yeah.
And that's really just what we've been doing, is just growing a little bit and a little bit and a little bit. And I was working at Lifetime at the time when she started baking out of the home. And, you know, it had grown to a point where, you know, I had to choose.
Yeah.
So
that's amazing. It's amazing how it started from you, and then you guys both partner up together. That's amazing.
I actually did a part time first.
Wow.
Yeah. So I was working a corporate job full time, doing the regular baking, and then I think it was my last. I don't know what year that was. What was the year we went to Hawaii? 2017 was, I mean, I would say I really didn't enjoy my job at the time. I was really stressed. My body was very tense. There were days where I was like, oh, I wish, what happened if I just drove through this intersection? Yeah. You know, like, what would happen? And I told him that, and he's like, you shouldn't be having those thoughts.
Let's
maybe
do something different.
Let's get a different job. Let's like change this up. So, but you know, leaving corporate is really hard because you have the job security, you're used to the schedule, you have the PT, you know, like all that stuff like that comes with it. Yeah. So I was really scared to leave that, but I mean, my body was telling me it wasn't the right place. And then this was starting to blow up as well. And he's like, well, if you want to, you can do it part-time, find a part-time job and do the baking part-time. So even when I was job searching part-time, you know, I kind of made it like really extravagant request. Like, I want this many hours. I want this pay. I wanted to have health benefits. Like, who has health benefits for part-time people, you know? Right. And I did find it. Yeah. And so I was like, oh man, I put it out there. I found the job. They want to hire me. But now I didn't, like, I hesitated to accept the job because I'm like, I don't know if this is the right thing. I need a sign. And then he, after I got off the phone with the interviewer, he sent me an article that they posted about us in Veg News or some kind of local. Yeah. I don't know if it was local or a little bit bigger vegan publication, but I was like, okay, I asked for a sign. That was the sign. He sent it right after I had the talk. And I was like, I need a sign right now before I call them and tell them that. Because they were surprised. They're like, oh, you were going to accept it right away? They're like, we do need to know right away. I'm like, oh, okay. I wasn't super serious, but I guess now I have to be serious. So yeah, I accepted. And so I went, worked part-time with the city of Roseville, and then did this part-time out of my home. And then again, kept growing, like people were ordering, picking up cakes and cupcakes from my house. And then, you know, Veg Fest kept selling out. And so we kind of talked about it.
And I mean, Minnesota has something called Cottage Law Bakery. So that allows home bakers to sell a certain amount of baked goods. And Minnesota has since extended that dollar amount that you can make, which is very helpful. And you know, so it, having that really helped. You know, I mean, we were never going to be able to jump right into a full scale bakery just because we just don't have that background. And then I would also say that the demand was there too. There was not any full scale vegan bakeries at the time, so people kept kind of saying, hey, is this something that you're going to put a brick and mortar in? Because we would really, 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 really support you if you did that. So having that carrot out there for us was also a really big push.
Nice.
Just because, you know, the demand was there.
Right. Yeah. It's nice that, because like they always say, when you do something, you have to be passionate about it, right? Because if you're not, if you're passionate about it, it's no longer work anymore. Yeah. And here you guys are years later, three locations. That's amazing.
Yeah. And I mean, also too, just to speak to that, you know, for us, you know, we really believe in veganism, right? And what that means and what that means for the animals, for the world, you know, so that's, I don't want to speak for Sheila, but that's where my passion comes from is to say like, okay, we can save lives by doing this. You know, cause I mean, she knows this more than anyone or as you know, it's hard work. It's extremely hard work.
Yeah, it is.
While she's up standing, working with her hands, you know, her back is hurting. I'm on the computer typing, doing accounting, marketing, that type of thing. So, you know, it's a little disingenuous for me to, you know, say it's hard work when for her it's harder.
Yeah.
But that's where my passion comes in personally is I think we're doing the right thing.
Yeah, that's amazing because in order to pay, people would use eggs, right? So what do you guys use differently?
And the cakes, like, you don't even need eggs. I don't know if I should say this, but I feel like
it's propaganda.
Yeah, like, we've just kind of been brought up to bake a certain way or to believe certain things about certain things. And so the more and longer I vegan bake, the more I'm like, do we really need eggs?
Yes.
Like, or did we really need the egg yolk or the egg white? Or did we really need, you know, milk? Like, people use water all the time, too. It's just like... I'm starting to question everything that, you know, like since I went vegan, I started questioning more about just the world itself and the belief systems that we have in general.
Well, but, and I mean, sorry to interrupt you, but she said something earlier, you know, she said baking normal.
Oh, yeah.
You know, and I don't think she intended to say it that way, but normal is terms of how we were raised to think of baking in that... You know, well, you have to use an egg. What's the substitute for egg? People will ask that question and we'll be like, well, we don't, well, there's a lot of items that we don't have a substitute for egg. And they're like, well, what do you mean? We're like, well, what do you mean? it doesn't need eggs, period. End of discussion. Next question. You know what I mean?
Yeah. So that's your way of baking. And so you guys substitute, so instead of milk, you do water.
yeah. So for the cakes, you, it's baking soda and vinegar does the science behind making it rise. It's the bubbles, it creates the bubbles to make that, you know, the fluffy cake. Yeah. The cookies, we do use egg replacement. It's called flax meal. It's just flax seeds that's grounded up and you mix it with water. Yeah. And it gets like the consistency of an egg. In our s'mores bars, we don't even use eggs. In our Pop-Tarts, we don't use eggs either.
Soy milk is the substitute for milk.
Yeah. Wow. Yeah. So piping, cake decorating is an essential part of cake, right? How long did it take you to perfect that?
Oh, it's been so many years now, so I don't even know. It just takes practice and consistency. Yeah. Like the more you do it, the more you learn kind of how to balance it, the pressure that you put, the angle that you hold, how fast can you go, how slow do you need to go to do this certain thing. Mm-hmm. So I would say basic cake decorating for me, I don't know, maybe like a month or two.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. That's so amazing. Just keep doing. I think I started off with cupcakes though. Yeah. So that's why cakes is maybe secondary. And basically just learn on YouTube. I just watch videos.
Okay.
And just watch a bunch of different ones and then kind of like take what works for me from each one and then apply it. Mm-hmm. Same thing with cupcake decorating. Just watch videos. Which ones were most helpful? Like, what did they say here? Would they do that? What tips did they give? Like, just trying to replay it in my head and just practice.
Wow, that's amazing. Yeah. It's a month. Only.
Well,
that's a short amount of time. I mean, you sat there and practiced for a long time.
If you're doing it straight day in, day out, it would be a lot shorter. So, like, if I had the opportunity to train my staff decorating, like, just a full 8 hours, I'm sure they'll get it in that 8 hours.
Right.
Like, it doesn't take that long. But because we're doing a lot of different things, too, in between, you don't get to do it consistently for that one time. But if you could, anybody could learn within 8 hours. Like,
well, it's a lot like anything else, right? Mm-hmm. Like some people have an aptitude for it and they can pick it up immediately.
Yeah.
Right. And then like for me, I'm not going to learn how to decorate cakes in 8 hours. I'm not going to learn in a month.
We should try.
It's not something that I have the aptitude for. Mm-hmm. So like we've learned that with our team and that some people pick it up immediately.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
Right. And they can start decorating cakes on the first day and be like, how long have you been doing this? We're like, oh, this is the first time, you know? And then some people, it just never clicks.
Wow. Do you guys, so with your three locations, you guys are so busy. How do you guys manage three locations, get all your items on the menu? How do you manage to do all that?
So I think it's good to kind of clarify maybe different roles that we play within the business. Mm-hmm. So I would say I'm more, you know, creative, and then also like production. Mm-hmm. So I am in charge of production and mostly in our production facility, which is White Bear. So wiper production, training, and then procedures and policies and stuff like that.
And she made all the recipes, too.
Well, it should be noted.
Right? So, like, she's not necessarily doing that now, but all that work was done on the front end. And that's weeks and weeks and weeks and weeks of trial and error, you know, and like, It was a ton of work, right? So just because she's not doing it today doesn't mean that it wasn't already done.
Yeah. I think that's one thing people forget. Like, I'm paying for this. It should be, like, cheaper. Like, you don't understand the time and education investment. Yeah, like, all the things that it took before I got here to get here. Like, it was, even though I didn't go to school for it, I learned it all on YouTube, Google, and Pinterest. But the knowledge accumulates in my head and I just kind of know what clicks now. I can easily make anything basically that I want because I have that experience now.
Yeah. Everything we do is we pay for their experience. It's kind of like a builder when you're buying a house, you're paying for the builder's experience.
Yep.
And so,
I think it is difficult for consumers to understand that. And I'm guilty of that as well, right? It's like, well, you know, this doesn't seem like that big of a deal. I'm not seeing the work that went into it years in advance. Mm-hmm. So, but in terms of how we balance the three locations, I would say, you know, the biggest thing is we have a really, really strong team. And I think we've gotten, you know, pretty good at identifying really great people who are core value fits for our company.
Okay.
And, you know, we do all of our hiring based on core values. So somebody could come into us and they could say, I don't have any experience doing this, but you know, I love your vision. I love, I'm vegan for the animals, you know, this, this, and this, and be like, yeah, absolutely. We want to bring you on and we'll train you, mm-hmm. right? So hire on passion and then train from there, mm-hmm. which I think has been a really important thing for us. So having a great, great team, mm-hmm. you know, especially now, yeah. you know, if you talk to a lot of restaurant owners, mm-hmm. it has been a struggle.
Right.
You know, for us, we have a team that wants to be there because they know that they're making a difference,
right?
So that helps us a ton.
Yeah.
So we aren't having a lot of the same problems that a lot of the other restaurant owners are having, getting people to show up, et cetera, because of that passion piece, because of our core values. So I think that's the biggest thing. We've also learned, and I don't want to speak for Sheila, but we've learned that, you know, there's only so much we can do, right? And it's a skill to be able to say, okay, you know, I did a good enough job here. It's time to step back a little bit and let the team take over, or, you know, because we're human beings after all, and we can push ourselves as far as we want until we burn out. And then it's like, okay, well now we need to do something else because this just isn't going to work. And I know for Sheila, I don't know if you want to speak about this right now, but with COVID in a lot of ways that helped you. And it's weird to say that, but why don't you explain? Sorry, I didn't mean to take over your hosting duties there, Maya.
I was just going to ask you guys how COVID impacted you and what changes it brought into your business.
Yeah. I like to say this quote in the Star Tribune quote too, but like, I like to say that COVID like saved my life.
Awesome.
Because it slowed everything down mm-hmm. and made me like forced me to mm-hmm. like reevaluate the business and my values and like how much time and energy do I want to put into it versus me as well, my mm-hmm. personal life, because although, you know, we have a lot of help, the team is great and I have a lot of trust in them. And you need that. Mm-hmm. And it's really hard because I want to control everything because it's my bakery. I want to control the quality, the way it's decorated, but I can't do it to meet the needs for everybody. So like I had to let go of that perfectionism mm-hmm. and just like trust the team. If it's a little bit different, it's okay. The product is still out there. People are still enjoying it. Mm-hmm. And most of the time, like only the cake decorators notice their mistakes. Like people that go, oh, it's beautiful. I'm like, okay, I hope you don't notice this little thing. But like, I don't even think normally people see that stuff.
Yeah, I think they don't, they probably don't realize the change, but the item speaks for itself mm-hmm. once you eat it,
sure.
right? Because I've tried your products and it just speaks for itself.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah.
So yeah, COVID really slowed everything down. And so we worked smarter. Like, why are we doing so many items when we don't have the capacity to do it physically and for me mentally? Like, I just can't plan for that anymore. So, you know, cutting down menu items and working on our core things, you know, cakes and desserts. And also, like, keeping tabs with our team. Just to make sure, are you guys okay? Like, what's the work volume like?
Yeah.
Are we doing okay?
Yeah.
So that, and then like realizing that I can't, what's that word? It's not sustainable long-term, what I was doing mentally and physically.
Yeah.
And so I was like, if I don't fix this right now, then there's going to be no veganese.
Yeah.
I'm going to be done.
Oh.
I want to quit. And not going to lie, so many times I wanted to quit, like owning a business, working on your feet.
It's extremely hard.
It's not just the product, the creativity. Yeah. Now you have to deal with suppliers and with everything, the cost, the goods and the paper goods and like so much stuff. And then plus on top, being a manager, doing processes and procedures and then training.
Yeah.
So it is a lot that goes into like running a food business, I would say, because that's only my experience as a food business. And it was a good journey.
Yeah.
It was very hard. I learned a lot. Still kind of processing it right now, how I feel about it. Like, do I still say it's like a good experience or a bad experience? Mm-hmm. So right now I'm kind of neither which way. I'm just kind of like processing, like, okay, I learned a lot though. Mm-hmm. It was very hard. But now I know how to balance my life and how to like save time for me.
And that's so important in relationship as well too.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Well, and I mean, it helped. It was kind of a reset button for a lot of businesses.
Yeah.
So one of our biggest mistakes we made was in 2018, Sheila loves to experiment, right? So she would experiment with something and I would taste it. I'd be like, okay, put this on the menu. Mm-hmm. right? Not thinking at all that like, oh, by the way, 12 of these 16 ingredients, we don't currently stock. Mm. So now we have to go and get these 12 mm-hmm. out of these 16 ingredients. Mm-hmm. So, and eight of those 12 are not going to be in another item. Mm-hmm. So I was very inefficient because she would create something. It would be awesome. And we always talk about our quiche. Yeah. She did a vegan mm-hmm. quiche. It was awesome. I was like, put this on the menu. And you know, what the pandemic allowed us to do is get rid of quiche.
Yeah.
Because it should have never been on our menu to begin with.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of people that really, really, really liked it. In fact, we got an email yesterday mm-hmm. about making one for a holiday celebration. So, and I know a lot of other businesses did this as well, where they're like, okay, what are some things we can pull back on?
Right.
Because this is the time to do it.
Right.
And our egos are such that we never want to admit that we made a mistake and just say, you know what, we need to get rid of this quiche because it doesn't make sense for our business.
Yeah.
Enter pandemic and we can say, oh, there's a pandemic.
Yeah.
Right? Oh, we can't do quiche anymore because we can't do this, and this, and boom, get rid of it.
Right.
So, you know, it was a built-in reset button for us.
Yeah.
And, you know, we were open probably too long. I shouldn't say we were open probably too long. We were open for too many hours at all of our locations. And this allowed us to kind of scale back and say, what should our hours be?
Yeah.
Because before the pandemic, you didn't want to put out new hours and then customers would be like, well, why are you changing your hours? Right. Like, I work till 6. Right. I need you to be open till 7. Right. And of course, that feels bad for us because that's a customer and they give us their money, their hard-earned money. They're coming from work to support us. Right? So, and I mean, should it be that way? Should it have needed a pandemic for us to be able to reset and say, no, this is what works for us? Yeah. And like what Sheila was saying, if we don't do this, the business is not going to exist because this is too much, right? And had we known then what we know now, we would have done the right hours. We would have done the right menu, but we didn't, right? And now we do. And I want to add on one other thing too. So Sheila's brother died during the pandemic as well. And he was 27, Alvin.
So,
and I think from my perspective, I don't want to speak for her, but that completely changed her perspective a lot just on life and work and, you know, work-life balance, if you will.
How short life is too.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yep. So.
Yeah. I mean, it's amazing how COVID positively impacted you guys. I mean, it affected so many businesses, but I'm so happy to hear that it positively impacted you guys and made you guys a lot stronger, and it brought more stuff into your business and you're able to make more time for family. So.
Well, and I mean, like, we didn't have a choice. Right? It's like, that was out of our control.
Yeah.
So the only thing that we could handle was how we reacted to it. You know, so sales were down.
Yeah.
They were down a ton.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, like they were for everybody else.
Right. Yeah.
But, you know, it's, oh, hey, could we stop with this pandemic thing?
Right.
No, it's like, we didn't have a choice.
Right.
Right. Exactly. So it's like, okay, how are we going to respond to this?
Right.
You know, and our team sees that as well. So, you know, and a lot of it is about building a culture within your building, you know, where your team feels supported and believes in you and stuff.
Yeah.
So.
Wow. So how many items on the menu do you guys have now? And do you guys have one that's like a hot item on your menu?
Oh my goodness. Like,
well, I mean, you know, our most popular items are our cakes, you know, and our most popular cake is probably our chocolate salted caramel cake or our cookie dough cake. Okay. One of those two is kind of a, and the chocolate salted caramel does come in a gluten-free version. So if I were to pick one item, it was probably our chocolate salted caramel cake. We do offer food as well. So I'd say all in all, we have probably between 20 and 25 different items, but the variations of that items, like I think there's 43 different flavors of cake, I think was the exact number that I came up with a couple months ago. So yeah, we have cake, but there's 43 different kinds of cake.
Wow, that's amazing.
You know? So, and it's probably still a little too many, right? I still think that we would like to narrow it down a little bit, but like, you know, for example, the s'mores bars on the table and the Pop-Tarts, like those are very time consuming to make.
Yes.
You know, we tried to I don't want to say get rid of them, but scale them back. And it just was like every, you know, we had customers coming in being like, hey, where are the Pop-Tarts at?
It's hard because you have people that want it, yeah. Right? It's a like, demanding item.
I'm here for a Pop-Tart. So do you have one for me or not? So yeah, I'd say about 20 to 25 yeah. with several dozen variations of
yeah.
each.
Yeah. And yeah. everything's handmade.
Yeah.
Pop-Tart,
yeah.
the dough is handmade and then rolled and cut yeah. handmade, worked the edges handmade. Yeah. The bars, everything's handmade except yeah. for the marshmallows and the graham crackers.
Yeah.
But, the frosting, like we hand make everything, and sometimes he will tell me that customers yeah. comment.
Where
like,
do you get your stuff?
I was like, what?
We make it?
Yeah, like I didn't understand that.
And that's yeah. okay. I don't mean to sound like that. Our customers are the reason that we exist. Yes. But it is funny to be like, to have somebody come in and be like, well, where do you order this
yeah.
from? I'd be like, well, you know, my wife and her team, they make it with their hands, yeah. respectfully.
Yeah.
Because, you know, like we don't have a choice. There, yeah. there is no place to order this from.
Yeah.
So I think that is funny. Uh-huh. I probably would ask that same question 10 yeah. years ago. You know?
Yeah.
So.
I mean, it's just so much hard work that you guys put into this, right? Like you said, people come in and they don't realize the hard work, the skills, mm-hmm. all the stuff it takes for you to come from where you started to where you are today. Mm-hmm. So it's just, it's amazing. Do you guys have any special events coming up? Do you guys cater? Do you guys do special orders? If people want a special order through you guys too for their events?
You want me to answer this?
Well, I mean, we do pre-orders, okay. right? So yeah. You can come into our stores mm-hmm. and buy a cake or buy a cupcake or that type of thing. But for birthday parties, mm-hmm. for weddings, people will pre-order in advance. Yeah. We have a 48-hour notice on that. So
okay.
we don't technically cater, okay. but we do weddings, right? Okay. You know, customers can order, you know, 12 dozen cupcakes and 2 wedding cakes, that mm-hmm. type of thing. So I guess that is catering in a way.
Yeah.
It's just, but no, I don't think the holidays are very busy for us.
Yeah.
So, and then Valentine's Day, of course, too, is yeah. right around the corner.
Yeah.
I would say we don't do special orders, like no custom orders.
Yeah.
So what I like to tell customers when they ask about that is like, we can take away something, but we can't add anything.
Oh.
So all the cakes come in the standard decoration. All the cupcakes come in a standard decoration. But if you don't want the pretzels, you don't want the sprinkles, you don't want the little dupes yeah. or whatever, you want just a plain cake so you can put your top around there. Okay with that. Like yeah. we'll definitely do that. And that's just because of training wise. So
right.
our staff just knows how to train the basic cakes.
Yeah.
They're not there for cake decorating per se. They're yeah. not cake decorators. We like don't have a specific role just for decorating yeah. cake. So they need to know how to do almost basically everything.
Yeah.
And so that's why we keep it simple and standard. But if you know me, then you're lucky. Like if you ask me, I'll
right.
do it myself for you.
I'll just privately call
yeah.
you.
So like I have a lot of friends and family that will just say yeah. like, hey, Sheila, can you do a cake this, cake that? And
yeah.
I will do that if I have the time. I'm
yeah.
like, yeah, I can fit it in. If they give a lot of times they're like,
yeah.
so like 2 days, I was like, I can't do it in 2 days.
Yeah.
You have to give me a week notice. But yeah, so the people who know me
yeah.
Can like message me privately and just be like,
yeah.
hey, I'm doing this, can you do that?
Yeah.
And I love doing that stuff.
Yeah.
So that's why one of the main reasons I got into vegan baking after I went vegan was just to show people that you can have a dessert
mm-hmm.
that tastes good
yeah.
and you don't need animal products.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So that was number one reason and mission for veganese. And then number two is because I get to be creative.
Mm-hmm.
And one thing I want to mention about the business aspect of that is like, yeah, sometimes it does suck to turn your hobby into
yeah.
your stream of income because
yeah.
you lose that passion
yeah.
for it. So yeah, I did lose the passion for a
mm-hmm.
while, you know, because I was doing the day-to-day stuff, baking
yeah.
every day, doing production, doing
yeah.
dishes. Like,
yeah.
This is not what
yeah.
I signed up for.
I didn't sign up to do dishes.
Yeah.
It's a lot of dishes.
It is, I bet.
It is so many dishes.
Yeah.
You wouldn't believe the amount of dishes in a bakery. It's crazy.
Oh, boy.
So, yeah, like, you can lose that if mm-hmm. you don't gauge and watch yourself.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And you have to have team members, you
yes.
know? Like, I have to trust and pay that they... trust that they're going to do that
mm-hmm.
And essentially, you know, pay them so that I don't have to do that. So it's
right.
less work on me.
Right.
And then I don't really touch the cakes anymore at
mm-hmm.
the store. So
yeah.
if I do it,
mm-hmm.
it's usually cakes I want to do
yeah.
for people, friends
mm-hmm.
and family. And then one thing that I want to speak to about like working with a business partner, because we're very different. I do, you know, all the creative day-to-day stuff.
Yeah.
He's like a big executioner, visionary, whatever. He does that and he's a leader for, you know, his team in Minneapolis. But like learning how to communicate with each other, yeah. like it was really bad.
Yeah.
In the first 2 years of our...
I cannot imagine working with my
husband. Exactly, yeah. It really pushed us and tested us and really honed us. And with my brother passing, like I started, you know, learning about boundaries and communicating and like why not do it now?
Yeah.
Why am I waiting? Why am I keeping this to myself? Like, why don't we just work it out now? Like now is the time. Mm-hmm. And so I've learned how to communicate better.
Yeah.
And so I can finally like say to him, you know, when I create these new things, it's because I need a creative outlet. That's what energizes me. That's what keeps me passionate about this. Doesn't mean I want it for the shop day-to-day sales. Like he said, there's so many ingredients. Mm-hmm. Like I just wanted to do it because it was a passion project. Yeah. I just needed to get that out of me. And so like if by me just communicating that to him, he's like, oh, okay, now I won't have to post it. You know, like I won't have to say it's available. Like it's just a limited time. It's this weekend or whatever. And I had to get him to be comfortable with that.
Yeah. Like,
sometimes I can just sell things on the weekend. Why not? It's my bakery. If I want to do that, people who come in that day, lucky, you get to try this, or you're going to drive all the way out. Good for you, you know? But I don't have to, we don't have to hold it every day of this, for the store. I think that's something you had to kind of work through yourself, but just me communicating to him made me feel better.
Yeah. Yeah. It's amazing how you guys make such a strong team. You know, you do the skills and he does the, he holds on to the office and does people. It's amazing how, how two of you guys can come together.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So I don't know how other business owners do it by themselves.
Especially like a vegan bakery doing it by yourself. I'm sorry. I just, no way.
Yeah,
it's the whole thing. Oh my goodness!
Yeah. I don't even.
And there
touch.
Are people that do it too.
Yeah, like I don't touch any of this stuff, and my brain would explode if I had to.
And I'm not doing. I'm not creating recipes. Are you kidding me? People would be like, "No, we're out of this."
Yeah.
No way. So we do make a good team.
Yeah. Wow. Do you guys have any long-term goals? Do you have any plans for the business? Can you talk a little bit about that?
I'll share that one.
Yeah, I mean, for us, you know, it's about getting better every day and just trying to, you know, do the best that we can with the information that we have. You know, I think for me, and I don't want to speak for Sheila, the team aspect has become a really, really, really important part of it. I think 15, 20, 25 years down the road, I want a team member of ours from 2020 to say, hey, that one thing you said to me that one day, that put me on this path towards this thing. And I'm so happy because of it. Thank you. Mm-hmm. Right. So, you know, that's where my goal is, right? Is to be a mentor for young people, to be that person that I needed when I was younger. I enjoy doing that. I think I'm decently equipped to do it. I'm learning every day as well how to be a better mentor. But for me to have somebody, you know, unprovoked call me their mentor or to say something like, hey, that thing you said to me, somebody said this to me the other day, that thing you said to me 5 years ago, that put me down this path. That affects me in a way that is really, really, really difficult to explain. And it feels amazing.
Yeah.
So in a lot of ways for me personally, I'm constantly working towards that feeling of inspiring somebody. Because to have somebody tell you that you inspired them, I mean, I'm sorry, there's just nothing, there's nothing like that. And that's probably happened, you know, three or four times in my life. And I can remember every single one. So to me, you know, that's my pursuit in terms of a business, in terms of business leadership. Also with veganism, you know, and as vegan business owners, we have to be very careful when we go down this path. But it is becoming more accessible, right? You can now go to Burger King and get a vegan Whopper, right? And I think every Burger King in the country has an Impossible Whopper on the menu. That was a pipe dream 5 years ago when we went vegan. And there was a lot of vegans that talked to us that had been vegan in the 80s, right? Where they were like, there was no options.
Yeah.
You know, so for us, we're trying to make it easier for people to leave animals off their plate, right? Because when I went vegan, initially I thought, I would tell friends, I don't think I'm going to be able to do this for the rest of my life. Right? It wasn't until I sat down at Pizzania in Northeast Minneapolis and had a vegan pizza that had a lot of herbivorous butcher topics on it, where I was like, oh, So I can eat pizza that tastes like this.
Yeah.
So I can be vegan now for the rest mm-hmm. of my life.
Yeah.
You know, because selfishly, I didn't think that I could eat well enough, taste, the tastes, you know, to want to be vegan for the rest of my life. I wasn't thinking of others. I was thinking of myself, right? So our goal is for when somebody has one of our products to say, wait a second, this is vegan. There's no milk.
Vegan cake?
There's no eggs. And people are like, it tastes like cake,
yeah.
right? My favorite thing to hear is when a customer says, we brought your products to a party and we didn't tell people it was vegan and they ate it. And then we told them afterwards and they all lost their minds,
yeah.
right? That's the best thing. So to make it easier for people to go vegan, right? Because I believe it's the right thing to do because that is a life that you are taking for your own personal enjoyment.
Yeah.
And, you know, we are here to make it easier for people. And I will stop talking.
Yeah. I think we never clarified what vegan was.
Yeah.
For me, being vegan or a vegan is just somebody who doesn't eat or consume or purchase.
Oh, absolutely. Yep.
That's made from animals. So, food-wise, it's no meat, no eggs, no dairy. So that's butter, ice cream, you know, traditional ice cream. Honey too. And then...
Clothing-wise, it's leather, it's wool, you know, anything that came from an animal. Because when you look at the grand scale of this stuff, I mean, it is vast and wide and massive. And we don't want to think about it, but, you know, it's incredible. Sorry, Sheila, go ahead.
No. I just wanted to define it so people knew.
It's essentially not using animals for your own, you know, benefit.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So clothing, food,
yep.
just your whole lifestyle, you changed it.
Yeah. Yep. Yeah. So then the bakery is vegan, so there's no eggs and dairy because there's no meat in bakery.
Yeah.
Baked goods anyways, but no eggs from chicken, no milk from a cow, mm-hmm. and no honey. Mm-hmm. So just wanted to clarify that.
Yeah, and I mean, our sugars are vegan because there are some sugars that are made using bone char, and so we don't use those. And
it's a whole thing. I mean, I would say we're not super I don't preach to people anymore. Everyone's on their path. Mm-hmm. I will share if they ask.
Yeah.
And I love bringing things and bringing food, and my family's really accepting of it.
Yeah.
My sister's always like, oh, I'm going to make this vegan for you or this vegan. So she did a lot of, transformed a lot of recipes to vegan when she lived with me. So that was really fun. We had a vegan Thanksgiving before. They're like, yeah, we'll do all vegan. And I was like, vegan. They don't know how much
it's amazing how
means.
Many people you guys inspire.
Well, and I mean, it's not effective to preach at people.
Yeah.
People don't want to be told that they're doing the wrong thing. So for us, it's like if we can just give them something that tastes really, really good, that they can maybe something goes off in their head and they're like, hey, I could do this.
Yeah,
I could do this. Absolutely.
Right. Yeah.
So because, I mean, that's how I was when I first started is I would be very preachy and, you know, and there is a place for that. I think that the people who do that, I think, you know, they do plant that seed in people, which can be effective. Mm-hmm. But for me, I wasn't seeing anybody getting over the finish line and saying, hey, I'm going to go vegan because you preached at me that one time, you know, and even my path towards veganism did not involve somebody preaching towards me. It was very, we didn't need to get into the story, but it was very organic how it happened. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. When I became vegan, it was very weird.
Yeah.
I was at work, you know, corporate job, watching a bunch of documentaries on sugar. Before we had the bakeries, I was like, how is sugar affecting our bodies and our brains and stuff? Because I kept hearing sugar is a drug. So I was like, I just want to learn more about what they mean by that.
Yeah.
So I was watching a bunch of that. And then one popped up. And as I was working, listening, I'm like, when are they going to talk about sugar? They never once said sugar in this documentary. But I heard a lot of plant-based and vegan. And I've never heard those terms before.
Yeah.
I'm like, well, what's going on here? And at the end, the guy asked, the question is, why don't we vegans not eat meat? But why do you eat meat?
Yeah.
And I was like, what? What kind of question is that? We eat meat because the animals are grown for us.
Yeah.
And I just left it at that. I continued on to the next documentary. And then I went to lunch. I was eating basically kodi, porridge with chicken.
Yeah.
And as I was eating it, I felt really sick, physically. I was like, oh, maybe I didn't make it right or heat it well, so I just tossed it.
Yeah.
So, you know, I'm not even sure what I had for dinner, but I just remember the next day at lunch, I had noodles and like little dried fish.
Yeah.
You know, I added to my noodles and they were just like floating in there looking at me. I was like, oh, I am feeling so sick right now, like physically sick. I can't eat this. So like I tossed that too. Yeah. And I went home. I was like, I don't think I can eat meat anymore. Yeah. Like, I don't know what's going on.
That was your moment.
Yeah. I was like, this is something's not feeling good. Yeah. So I was like, I'm going to just try it for a week and we'll see. Yeah. I was like, you can do whatever you want, but I can't be cooking, eating meat. So then my sister came to visit us and we went to HMONG Village because she wanted the pork belly.
Yeah.
I was like, oh, I was going to have some pork belly. Like, it's okay. It'll be fine. And as I was eating it, like I felt like physically and now mentally sick. And I'm thinking about, this is fat.
Yeah.
This is fat of an animal. Number one, it's not healthy. Pork belly is not healthy. But also then number two, I'm like, as I'm just chewing it, I'm just not feeling good. I was like, okay. So that was like my last intentional meat meal. Mm-hmm. So after that, I was like, okay, I'm done. I can't do it anymore. And it's been how many years now, dear?
I'm a vegetarian 15, vegan in 16.
Wow.
So 5 years vegan.
Yeah.
Yeah. So 5 years, no meat. I'm still alive. If I ate more whole foods, more vegetables and fruits, I would look better. But I eat a lot of like fake meat.
I think you look
cheese.
Great.
Oh, thank you. I could be better if I ate better, if I treated my body a little bit better. So just because you're vegan doesn't mean you're gonna be healthy, because there's so many vegan cheese, vegan cream cheese, vegan sour cream, vegan meats. So if you want to be healthy and be vegan, then I would suggest eating whole foods like salads, smoothies, juices. Grains, like
rice.
Real food that comes from there.
I mean, there's plenty of whole foods that are vegan, you know, rice and beans, vegetables, fruits,
apples,
all
cream,
sorts of stuff.
Yeah.
So, you know, people will come into a store and they're like, I've never had anything vegan before. And I'm like, well, yeah, you have. You've had an apple. I know you've had an apple. So, but it's interesting how our brain thinks that way. It's like, well, I've never eaten vegan before.
Yeah.
You've eaten vegan a lot in your life. So,
wow. Yeah, so we talk a lot about how you guys, COVID impact, and you guys had a strong relationship. So aside from business owning and baking, what do you guys do on your free time? What do you enjoy doing?
Mm. You want to start, or I can start.
I guess I'll go first. Hang out.
Yeah.
Making up lost time with friends and family. So my sisters and I have a Sunday fun day. So we hang out on Sundays, grocery shopping, going to eat, doing stuff. Although it's kind of changed now that it's wintertime, because it's harder to like be out. Also, I don't want to be spending money. So like, you know, we like to shop and we're together. So I'm like trying to avoid that. Yeah, I was like, no, I don't need to spend money. Don't tempt me. And then I also do, you know, my other business on the side, which is more spiritual. Mm-hmm. That business is called My Light Within. And it's actually the best way for me to describe without like scaring people, because people hate the word hypnosis.
Yeah.
But it's really natural. We're all in a hypnotic state every single day in our life. So when you're doing laundry, you know, you're in a trance. You're just folding clothes. You're not paying attention.
Right.
When you're exercising, you're not there either. Your mind is somewhere else. That's hypnosis. You're in a trance. So instead of using hypnosis, I use the word trance, like you're in a trance. So I put you in a, you know, we go in a trance, I relax you, and then we explore whatever the person came to see me to explore. So if you believe in past life, it's a past life that we're exploring, and it's coming up to show you whatever you need to learn about. Like, say you're having like body pains or issues with your mom, and that's why you came and you want to talk about it and see what comes up.
Yeah.
If you don't believe in past life, then it's your subconscious mind just creating a story to help you understand what's going on and how to apply changes.
We'll have to talk more after.
I really love it. It's really spiritual, but it doesn't have to be too. Like hypnosis is really scientific, but I'm more on the spiritual side. So I prefer, it's nicer and easier for me to see those kind of people, because then I don't have to explain the terms that I use as much, and they understand what they're coming in to do. But it's open to anybody, really. Yeah. Even if you just want to experience it or have a relaxing day, like just come in, because you're laying down.
Yeah.
I'm just helping you relax.
Yeah.
And then we're just talking. So like, it's kind of like a guided meditation is like what I like to call it. Because you're just, you know, when you're, I don't know, for people who do meditate, you're just sitting there, you know, just relax, and you're focused in your mind and not on your body and not your to-do list or meals or laundry or whatever. So that's basically what it is, a session. You come in, we talk about what you want to talk about. I learn about what you want to discover, and then we go into the trance, you relax, and then we see what you have to say for yourself. Like, wow. I'm not doing any work. You're doing all the work.
Are they recorded?
Yeah.
Wow.
So the audio, it's an audio recording. Okay. And I send it to the people after they're done. Yeah. And it just is a reminder to them, like, what did they say? Wow. What was the message to yourself?
Yeah.
What tips did you give yourself? You know, what did you reveal that you maybe didn't realize before? Mm-hmm. So I love doing that, like, because I love talking to people. I love holding space. I love getting deep. Yes. I'm like a very intimate person. Yeah. So even with my friends, we talk about like everything.
Yeah.
Like, I don't really like small talk. It's like so boring. I want to know deep. I want to know what happened to you when you were a child. Like, how are your relationships? How well do you communicate? Like, just listening and learning. Mm-hmm. And then I love if they're open to it, me giving, you know, talking about my experience and like giving tips and whatever too. So it's really like a conversation back and forth. It's just human to human, you know, nobody's better than another person. I'm just holding space. I'm just there for some people to come and share and vent, or, you know, have somebody to talk about.
Yeah.
Right? Yeah. It really lights me up. It's I get so excited. I love it. I'm like, yes, come. Yeah. It's fun for me. I hope it's fun for the person.
Yeah.
You learn a lot about yourself. Mm-hmm. And just a really neat experience in general.
Yeah. Wow. That's amazing. I'll have to message you.
Yeah, come see me.
I started a mini golf company during the pandemic called Puttcraft.
Okay.
Which has been a lot of fun. I enjoy the sport of football, watching it. And I watch other television series. When I'm home, I'm going to be watching TV, relaxing, because we do enough work.
Yeah. So. I mean, we work so hard, but sometimes we need to just rewind, sit down, and just do things we enjoy in life, too. Because if we continue to do what we do every day and we have no time for personal, it'll be really hard. So I'm glad that you guys make time for that, too. So before we close this up, do you guys have any advice for other people that want to pursue something that you guys pursue, or any business owners? Do you guys have any advice for them?
I guess I'll go first. I would say pick a really good partner. Mm-hmm. I would say we weren't great partners in the beginning, but we had to because we're married.
Yes.
So we worked through that and learned a lot about communicating, working with your strengths.
Yeah.
You know, I'm not going to ask him to be in the kitchen. He's not going to ask me to do the books. Yeah. I don't do that. I could do it if I was taught, but I don't enjoy that. That's not where my strength and my passion is. So know your strengths, stick to that, get help if you need help, a good partner that you trust, and good team. You have to have a good team and you have to trust. If you don't do that, you're gonna drive yourself crazy.
Right.
Like that, you have to let go in some shape or form a little bit, even though it's your baby, you know, like, you have to do
letting
that.
Letting go is the hardest part.
Yes.
And
then I would say, in business and in general, just be open and honest and communicate. Mm-hmm. Like, that's the biggest thing I'm learning now and that I'm implementing in my own life, is just always being honest and communicating. That way everybody's on the same page.
Yeah.
We can know what's going on. You can talk about it if you want to. You don't have to. I don't force anybody to.
Right.
I don't force my staff to talk to me or my team to talk to me. Mm-hmm. But if they want to, I'm there and open. Open communication, know your strengths. Don't forget to follow your passions too. Like, don't get sucked up in the day-to-day stuff. Do delegate, have people do that so that you can do your creative stuff or do your whatever it is that you're passionate about.
I love this question. So thank you for asking it. And also thank you for having us on.
Oh, yeah.
This is really great.
Yes.
We really, really, really,
so glad
really, really appreciate it. So I'll keep it to two things, right? If you're lucky enough to know exactly what it is that you want to do, which not a lot of people do, right? which is fine, right? When you're young, you don't necessarily have the experience to know that, oh, this is not what I want. This is what I want. If you are lucky enough to know what you want to do, and even if you aren't, I would find a great mentor, right? That is 1B for my advice of that I would give people, is to find somebody who you can talk to, who you can rely on, who you can bounce ideas off of, who's going to be a merciless friend for you, who's going to say, hey, Mai,
that's important.
I don't think that what you're doing here is the right thing. And let me explain to you why. And then you go back to them and back and forth and back and forth, right? Somebody who can tell you the stuff you don't want to hear. right? So I think a really strong mentor is is important. My life changed completely when I found some great mentors at my last job. I mean, complete 180. It was amazing. And then I would also say, you know, the best advice that I ever received was to believe in yourself, right? Because we have so much, I have so much doubt, you know, and I don't want to speak for anybody else, but a lot of us have doubt about things that we can do, and we are capable of some absolutely amazing, spectacular things. I mean, humans landed on the moon, right? You know what I mean? It's like, it's like we're talking about opening a restaurant, which is a lot of work. Don't get me wrong. Meanwhile, people are flying around in space, you know, performing open heart surgery on babies. It's like there's just like incredible things that human beings are capable of. You know, there's also some awful things that human beings are capable of as well, which we don't need to touch on. But, you know, believing in yourself, being your strongest supporter is it's an incredible superpower. And it can be taught. It can be learned. And I cannot think of a better piece of advice to give people than to believe in yourself.
Yeah, I really love that. Mentorship and letting go, having trust in people. And so, I mean, these are really great tips. I'm in business too, and I think that when I first got into business, having a mentor that you can trust and you can bounce ideas off is it's a very powerful tool.
So. And I mean, if it's some, I mean, a lot of people want a friend or a mom. It's like, you know, if you can find somebody who's outside of your circle, that's going to be even more powerful too. So,
Wow. Well, thank you for coming.
Thank you.
Thanks for having
I really
us.
Enjoyed having you guys on the show. Thank you for coming. So, friends and families, thank you so much for joining with us today. I hope you guys had some good takeaways. And if you guys are in the area, we will post their locations. There's two locations in Minneapolis and one in White Bear Lake. So if you guys are in the area, feel free to stop by and support them. We want to support our local businesses so we can all continue to thrive. So thank you so much for tuning in to the My Miller Show today. I will see you guys next time. If you guys have a business and you guys want to be featured on my show, feel free to reach out to us. I would love to have you on my show. So this is My Miller. I will see you next time. Wow.